Thomas, happy to have you here, joining our little digital roundtable and the Spring Salon. It's been a follow-up of the Winter Salon, what we had in January with different speakers. And you've been on our list for quite a while, so we're really happy to have you join us and hear a bit more about your practice. I don't know what is a good way for you. Maybe you want to present and students ask questions, or we can drop them in the chat, or... What is your approach?
Either and both would be fine. You know, feel free to drop a question in the chat, and then maybe I can kind of, you know, I can address it either like as I go or at the end. Obviously, I've got like a, you know, some slides which I will share. I can just kind of do that, share my screen and all of that.
Yeah, but nice to have you here, because I think lots of students, the GOAT project has been used quite a bit by students as kind of a reference, especially when we talk about new narratives or forms of empathy or talking about non-human, those conversations are happening.
Okay, all right. No, so you're familiar with my work already. As in,
will
talk about the GOAT project.
It's been referenced by students.
Okay, all right. Well, I'll try and like go through it so we can have time for questions. That would be good. So I'll be quick. I'll try and be quick. So I'm going to share my screen and I'm going to share sound as well.
Yeah,
that's good. Here we go. And I'm going to swap to Keynote and I'm going to press play and I'm going to say hello. Yes, hello. And thanks for kind of inviting me. It's kind of been quite a long time to set this up, hasn't it, Judith? We got there. Great. So a little bit about me. I didn't actually start off as a designer. I started off kind of thinking I'm going to be a computer scientist and do AI. And then I swapped to the life sciences because I just couldn't face the thought of like staring at a screen for my whole career. Then after that, I was kind of wondering, should I do a PhD in bioinformatics or something like that? But then kind of got diverted by this course at the Royal College of Art, where Yuri Suzuki also went. I was kind of a few years after him, but, you know, kind of part of the same, slightly part of the same cohort, I suppose. And the course was this course that was interested in kind of collaborating with the sciences, basically, kind of investigating the sciences through design and kind of thinking about futures. And so that's sort of what I've continued to do since then in my own practice. And so recently I've been working with a biologist at Imperial College, Naomi Nakayama, and she works on kind of cellular biology, but she's been cellular plant biology, but she's been helping me with this project, which has been to like make prosthetic trunks for trees. So the idea is that I'd like to be able to keep branches of trees alive after having kind of cut them from their host trunk. And so I've kind of made this sort of artificial tree or prosthetic for trees. And I'm also currently working on a project at the moment. I'm going to be in Amsterdam at a zoo, at Artists' Zoo for 3 weeks, where I'm going to be trying to make a harmless car. And I don't know what it's going to look like. This is not my work, somebody else's work, but I'm collaborating with a professor at Delft University to kind of, he's produced these kind of optimized car shapes. The idea is I'm going to weave this car from willow, because I don't know. It's like, obviously it's an impossible task to make a harmless car, but the first step is to make a chassis. And so I'm going to weave these kind of this chassis from willow stalks. It's the kind of most harmless way I could think of to make a chassis. But I'm kind of trying to do it in this kind of high-tech way where the stresses for this chassis have been kind of optimized, using this kind of, you know, computer optimization, which I'll talk a little bit about later. I'm not sure what it's going to come out like. Hopefully a bit not like this, but a bit like this. And then I want to kind of drive this car around. So that's what I've been doing recently. But when I get kind of asked to present my work, especially to kind of students, there's stuff about like this kind of this, the kind of project I do, which the harmless car is a will definitely be a continuation of this kind of style of project, which I do, which I began doing when I did the toaster project, which is essentially I kind of set myself like a task, like a goal, and then try and do it. And the task I've realized is nearly always kind of impossible. So to create a harmless car is going to be impossible. It turns out creating this project I did, which was to create an electric toaster entirely from scratch, turns out that was impossible. And of course, becoming a goat is impossible. And so this project to create a toaster, I don't know, it's like a kind of, maybe you've seen it as well, but it was this began with this kind of deconstruction process of like, how can I make this kind of cheap mundane object entirely myself from scratch? And I kind of set it up as a sort of like, I would like to make just one thing myself from the beginning. And again, it involved like roping in various kind of experts from across the sort of sciences into this project to make this toaster, and you know, visiting like abandoned mines and kind of trying to make a sort of thing to smelt metal, to, you know, so I got the iron ore and then tried to smelt it using this furnace, and that didn't work, so I ended up using a microwave to smelt this metal, and you know, kind of managed to make some iron and managed to make some copper. But then also I decided I needed my toaster to have a plastic case. And so after trying and failing to make plastic, you know, ended up visiting this kind of plastics recycling factory. Yes, talking to the CEO of this kind of plastics recycling firm. And I'll play you this video now.
Does flame retardancy mean anything to you at all?
Yeah. I was wondering if I could actually mine some brominated flame retardants from myself and put them in my toaster. But,
Oh dear. Yeah.
So after, you know, 9 months of sort of struggling to deal with all of these kind of different materials, I managed to kind of make this toaster, and then, you know, kind of took it to a shop and got this image. And maybe we can talk a little bit about this later, but, you know, on the one hand, the goal of this project was to make a toaster. On the other hand, the goal of this entire 9 month kind of process was to like get this image, and to get this kind of image with that like price label in there, you know, because I didn't really want to make a toaster, obviously. What I wanted to do was I wanted to kind of talk about economies of scale, and I wanted to talk about you know, this fact or this idea that we're not paying the true cost of things. There's lots of kind of, you know, the pollution that a toaster creates is, you know, is not reflected in the cost. But I also wanted to talk about how wonderful it is that we've got all of these kind of brilliant, like convenient, you know, thank God for technology kind of thing. And so trying to navigate that kind of slight dilemma between like sustainability and technology and kind of wanting a kind of comfortable life with consumer goods and kind of knowing it's like, you know, not going to be possible to continue in the same, or it's not possible to continue in the same way in the future. So yes, so it's like this long kind of process of like struggle to create something which is ultimately a failure. Which brings me to the GOAT project. And this project again began with this like seemingly simple like desire, which was I got a bit upset and pissed off with life while I was looking after my niece's dog, and had that kind of thought, which was like, noggin the dog. Noggin, you don't have to deal with any of this crap that I'm dealing with. Money worries, am I wasting my life? You know, I've just had an argument with my girlfriend, et cetera, et cetera. You're oblivious. Wouldn't it be lovely to just be this dog and not kind of have to care about anything? And this is a, you know, this kind of question has been, return, you know, brought up by kind of philosophers of ethics and so on. Would it be better to just like not care, and then we could live a happy life? And you know, the philosophers tend to come down on the side of no, it's always better to care, and it's always better to know it, you know, it wouldn't be better to be the pig, it's better to be the human. However, you look at Noggin has a very pleasant existence. Of course he gets like upset, but he doesn't worry and he doesn't regret. He's like completely in the moment, you know, and you know, being in the moment is something that we're kind of told to, we should try and be, live life for today, etc. So I kind of started thinking, wouldn't it be nice to at least have a holiday from human kind of concerns and worries and, you know, regrets and all of that, and to just like gallop away and escape. So it kind of became a bit of like a dream. And then I wrote a funding application to a charity called the Wellcome Trust, who kind of are interested in the arts and sciences, saying, can you give me some money to become an elephant? And to my surprise, they gave me some money. And it was like, great, I'm going to be an elephant. But I did a bit more research and quickly realized that becoming an elephant to escape human worries and concerns was not a good idea, because turns out elephants are one of the only other animals that kind of seem to exhibit like signs that they understand their own mortality. And they live in these kind of complex social units, these complex families, and the complexity of family was exactly the kind of thing I was trying to escape from. So then I went to the pub and was kind of, you know, moaning to a friend, oh, I've got all of this money to become an elephant and I don't want to be an elephant anymore. What do I do? Oh, isn't life tough? And she said, well, why don't you consult an expert in human animal transformation? And so she sent me off to visit a friend of hers who's a shaman, who lived in Copenhagen. And I went to visit this kind of expert, this non-scientific expert, but this expert nonetheless. And she kind of sat me down and said, okay, well, you're an idiot for thinking you could become an elephant. Of course you couldn't become an elephant. You could only become an animal that was kind of closer to you, that you had some shared history with. And after kind of thinking that maybe I should become a sheep, because we have lots of sheep in England, she eventually said, actually, Thomas, I think you should become a goat. And I was like, yes, that is the animal for me. And she also said, you know, this idea that you're pursuing is not a new idea. Humans have been trying to become non-human animals for about as long as we were humans. And so this is a kind of cave of a, you know, bird human on a cave drawn 16,500 years ago in France, but much more discovered or understood, you know, discovered to Western science much more, or to, you know, establishment science much more recently, you know, in the last few years, was this. And this is believed to be an image of a human animal hybrid drawn on the wall of a cave in Indonesia. And this is from 44,000 years ago. So insanely long time. And this is the oldest piece of figurative sculpture discovered, carved from mammoth ivory, and discovered in Germany. But you kind of, you know, we're still fast forward to today, and kind of pop culture is kind of littered with these like human animal hybrids. But I wanted to kind of find out basically what sort of present day science and technology had to say about this ancient human kind of dream. So I started going to visit these experts. This is an expert in goat behavior, a kind of goat behavioral psychologist. And we went to visit his research subjects at kind of Buttercup's Sanctuary for Goats. And this is a kind of heaven on earth for goats. But I asked him, you know, what makes me different from a goat? And he said, well, we don't know exactly, but we think that, you know, the main differences are humans think in stories. We kind of make a story from our life, our regrets. When we remember the past, we kind of remember it as a sort of story. When we kind of think about the future, or when we're sort of thinking about what we might do in the future, we kind of think of it as a story, a scenario with ourselves in it. And, you know, we can imagine what would happen if we attach a heavy thing to a kind of wooden handle. We might get a club or a hammer or whatever. Those, you know, they're all kind of scenarios or stories. And then once we have these stories, we kind of have this compulsion to communicate them, you know, usually in words. So then I went to a neuroscientist and, you know, asked him to switch off my ability to use to think in stories and to kind of speak. And he said, well, I could, but that would involve kind of switching off like about 2/3 of your brain and then you die. But what I can do is maybe switch off a small part of your brain which is involved in kind of speaking. So he tried to do this using transcranial magnetic stimulation. Basically a strong electromagnet placed on the skull will interfere with the electrical activity of the brain in that region.
I suppose it could be, who's that trip trapping over my bridge, said the dog.
And it kind of worked. It was basically just unpleasant. He kind of said, look, come back in like 20 years or 50 years and maybe I'll have the technology to kind of selectively switch off the parts of your brain that will make you kind of get closer to a goat's perception. But we're at the very beginning of our understanding of the brain. So I kind of moved on to the body thinking this would be easy because we're so kind of close in anatomy to goats, and went to the workshop and started kind of making these like exoskeletons that would let me like gallop away and escape and like just live wild, and proved more difficult than I was thinking. This isn't exactly the kind of freedom that I was. And I'd been inspired by the kind of four-legged robots that kind of seem to be able to just like, you know, do all these amazing kind of flips and stuff. And so I went to visit a professor who had like worked on those kind of Boston Dynamics robots, and said, what am I doing wrong? If you can make a robot kind of run on four legs, surely you should, it should be easier to make a human run on four legs than it is to make a robot do it. But he said, no, quite the opposite, because you're kind of, you're lumbered with this existing kind of, you know, these, this existing anatomy. And we started, you know, walking around his place of work. He worked at the Royal Veterinary College, and it gets a bit gory now, this. So I'm going to show some slides of dissection. So, you know, watch out if you're sensitive. He was in the middle of dissecting a snow leopard. I said, how many goats have you dissected? He said, none. And I said, could we? And he said, yeah, sure, if you bring me a dead goat. And I started thinking, like, where could I get a dead goat from? So I went back to the goat sanctuary and kind of asked if they had any dead goats. And it was a little bit difficult because, of course, all of these goats have names. But after kind of some kind of quite tricky conversations, they said, look, there is a goat called Venus who is dying, but we don't know what of. So you can have her body as long as the vets at the goat sanctuary also kind of tell us what she died of. And so Venus died, unfortunately she died on a Sunday. So she had to spend the night in my fridge. But then the next day I took her to the Royal Veterinary College and kind of began this very interesting process of like how this, you know, this kind of animal, how does it kind of move, you know, watching this animal turn from an animal into kind of something much more familiar from a butcher's shop and so on. But what was interesting was it was a kind of very visceral really brought home to me the difference between a kind of engineering mindset, something you might design on like SolidWorks, and a kind of like an evolved version of the same thing. So you might be familiar with this kind of image, you know, one side, one bracket is a kind of engineered bracket, then the other bracket is a kind of optimized by a kind of evolutionary algorithm, the same bracket after it's been kind of optimized by sort of evolution perhaps, and it's just kind of a completely different way of thinking. So I realized, of course, that I needed prosthetics. And so I went to visit some doctors of prosthetics, and they agreed to make me some goat legs and took casts of all my limbs. And while they were doing that, I looked into kind of how I could make myself an artificial rumen. You know, this is a goat's rumen, this is Venus's rumen, but I needed to make an artificial one. So that's what I tried to do, because I didn't want to be lumbered with money. I wanted to just, like a goat, be able to kind of eat anything and digest it. And the reason why a goat can digest anything, or can digest, you know, the cellulose and kind of plant matter that humans can't, is because they have a whole extra stomach specialized, you know, full of kind of microbiology, which is specialized in kind of breaking down the cellulose in grass and other matter. So I collaborated with some rumen biologists on this, but eventually I had to stop kind of researching and stop visiting people and just kind of put it all together. So I went off to Switzerland to live on a goat farm, and arrived on the day when the goat herd, this is Sepp, the owner of the goat herd, he was just going to herd the goats down to a different pasture from like up in the, from the high in the mountains down to the valleys. And so I woke up very early in the morning and kind of for a few brief minutes was like with the herd, running with the goats. And it was like, yes, I'm doing it. But eventually, you know, quite quickly, the landscape just became very steep and the goats just like flowed down it like water. And I was left like really kind of struggling, putting one hoof in front of the other, worried I was going to fall and smash my face open, feeling very human and kind of my knuckles were starting to rub raw, but I basically had to plod on, and eventually much later that day kind of caught up with the goats. So I was, you know, trying to become a goat for 6 days. Three of those days were with this herd of goats. Eating was always a problem because I'd never worked out how to like extend my neck. So I had to kind of, you know, so after 3 days, you know, I kind of left the herd to try and kind of achieve this like romantic idea of a wild animal. So I wanted to like de-domesticate and become a wild ibex and disappear into the Alps. And it turns out as long as I was going up, my prosthetics were actually quite good. It was when I was going down and my body weight was on the kind of on my arms that they became really difficult and painful. So let's pretend that I just kind of headed off up into the Alps and disappeared. So that's the kind of story of the project, and it kind of became a book and sort of, but since then I've been trying to work out what it is actually about and why I became kind of, why it was sort of like an unpleasant project to do in some ways. And I've realized that it's because, it's kind of because of like this, slightly subconscious belief that I had, or maybe that we sort of have in this, like that things will get better somehow, that like civilization is on an upward trajectory perhaps. And, you know, ultimately we follow this kind of graph of gross domestic product against, you know, over time, if we kind of just keep it going up and into the future, then Star Trek, The Next Generation, where it's this version of Star Trek where humans are very wise and, you know, they look back on the 20th century as this terrible brutish time, and, you know, and this idea of like evolution, we're going to kind of evolve to be better, not just two hands, but three hands. And I realized doing the goat project that, you know, I was trying to kind of, that evolution doesn't have a direction, and I was trying to kind of just think of the future as, why can't we just be happy on a hillside, not going anywhere, not building anything better, just like living and dying kind of thing. And a sociologist around in the 70s, social psychologist Ernest Becker, he said, well, okay, this is why we have religion or nationalism, but because humans need to believe that we're part of something bigger. And although I'm not religious, I realized that I needed to believe that human civilization was kind of something bigger, you know, it was kind of going to progress somehow. And yes, we'll kind of, you know, there will be bumps in the road, but ultimately, you know, we're progressing to some kind of destination. And of course, that's rubbish. Yes, Ernest Becker said that we are gods with anuses. We are kind of godlike in, you know, we have this view, this kind of consciousness and this idea of the future and the past, but we also have this kind of animal nature, which is like we kind of shit and die and you know, and we're always struggling to kind of to deal with that. And I guess with the GOAT project, I was trying to kind of think of the future as less godlike and more kind of animal-like. And perhaps that's where we need to go somehow to kind of, you know, as we sort of approach changing our lives to become more sustainable. So there you go. So there's Venus posed as a human. But so yes, so I can't actually see the chat. I don't know if there's any questions. I mean, one thing I should talk about is like, this is how these projects they turn into books and kind of turn into like, they're quite media friendly because of these sort of story aspects to them. And they also are exhibited as kind of assemblages of the kind of performance aspect of them or the sculptural aspect of them. So they're kind of, yeah, slightly, I don't know exactly what they are, but yeah. So yes, that's that, I think.